stuff. We're going to be playing some kickball this week, just running around. We will do our best to not congregate too close, so we have hand sanitizer. We understand for some people that they're not quite ready for that. There's no pressure to join. But if you have a middle school through high school student and you're interested, we'd love to have you come on out. If you have any questions, you can just let me know. Also, we've got another fun big event coming up on June 20th. If you know Lulu's Frozen Yogurt, we are partnering with Lulu's to offer free frozen yogurt to everybody. And then we'll be playing virtual bingo. All right. We do this once a month where we provide food and just get together online and have fun together playing bingo. So again, that'll be June 20th. You'll have more information if you're on our mailing list. If you have any questions, just let me know. All right. That's all the announcements that I have. I realized today that, man, we have a lot going on as a country, as a community, just between the coronavirus and now just all the unrest, especially in many of our major cities, with Denver, even here in Colorado Springs, not to that extent that we're seeing in some places. And I know a lot of you have connections to some of the cities like Minneapolis that are experiencing all these things. There's a variety of opinions and views. I'm not going to get into that today, but today is Pentecost. It's the day we celebrate when the Holy Spirit came to Jesus's disciples after he had ascended into heaven. And I think what a need it is today for the Holy Spirit to come and be present, in our church, to be present in our families, but friends, to be present in our communities, in our nation. I know, again, there are lots of different views, and I'm not going to go back and forth on them, but I think one thing we should be united is we need the Holy Spirit to work. We need Jesus everywhere. We need more people to come closer to him. If you want to see true change, that's where we need to start, on that foundation. And so as followers of Christ today, with love for our brothers and sisters all over, we come today and just ask for peace. We just ask for unity. We just ask for love to triumph over all things. We pray today especially that that Holy Spirit that came at Pentecost, that Holy Spirit that changed a world by giving courage and strength to those disciples, those scared disciples hiding in an upper room in Jerusalem, that Holy Spirit would work in our lives to help us to live differently, to love differently, to be courageous in our faith. So with all that, let's come before God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you with lots of burdens today. We think about just the last 2.5 months that we've been through, how much uncertainty and unknowns and fear that we have just been inundated with. Lord, between coronavirus and now all the unrest that's happening in many of our cities, we ask, Lord, for peace. We ask for peace in our own hearts. We ask for peace among our brothers and sisters. We ask for peace that only you can bring. Help us, Lord, not to stand in judgment, not to stand in anger, but to open arms in love. Help your love to be experienced, to be felt, to be seen throughout our country today, throughout our world. We pray especially for those who are angry, for those who have been wronged in many ways, for those perhaps who have been stuck inside with coronavirus or have lost jobs or family members or themselves are just in fear of what could happen. Lord, we ask for your peace. We ask for your comfort. And today, as we remember Pentecost, the day when you sent your Holy Spirit to that group of scared disciples, we ask for that Holy Spirit to come to us in our fear, in our worries. We ask for that Holy Spirit to work today, to just touch our hearts, to give us that strength, not strength to do great things for ourselves, but strength to live out our faith, to live differently. We pray for our families, especially for all those who've got kids and grandkids, and we just look at what they're growing up with right in this moment, and I've seen the fear in our very own youth. Lord, I ask that you would be with them, that you would give them that comfort. Help us to surround them in love. All this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus, the only one who can do all this. Amen. All right. Thank you very much. We've got here at our house, we've got Cedra and Caleb. Jessica is down in Arizona, but they're going to be leading us in a couple songs. This morning when we were praying together, I put their names together by mistake and ended up saying Cedra, which is kind of like, you know, one of those Hollywood couples where they put the husband and wife together. So this morning, here's Cedra.
For you, and we're living all for you. mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. And nothing compares to the promise I have.
Thank you, Caleb and Sadra. Indeed, nothing compares to the promise I have in you, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Well, boys and girls, it is time for our kids' message. So if you want to get a little closer, we've got our children's message for today. Here we go.
Hi, boys and girls. I have another word of the day today. In fact, it's two words. What are these two words? Mess up. That's right. What does it mean if you mess up? That's right again. It means you make a big mistake. Usually a mistake that causes some kind of mess. Well, today, to talk about messing up, I have my friend Gus, who's an English sheepdog, here with me. Would you like to meet Gus? Great. Come on out, Gus. Come on. All right, boys and girls, this is Gus. Can we say, hi, Gus? All right, he says hi back. All right, well, Gus and I today are going to sing a song that I wrote all about messing up. It's a really, really wonderful song. And in fact, Gus loves to hear me sing this song because Gus thinks that I have a beautiful singing voice. He thinks my voice... No, you don't think I have a beautiful singing voice? What's that? My voice... When I sing, sounds like a duck with laryngitis. Hey, it does not. All right, fine, Gus. If we're not gonna sing a song, what do you wanna do? You wanna show us something. All right, you know what? Let's ask the boys and girls. Boys and girls, would you rather hear me sing a beautiful song, or would you rather see Gus show you something? What? You wanna see Gus instead? Oh, fine. All right, Gus, what did you bring to show us? Oh, it's right over here. Okay, oh, look at that. What are these? That's right, they are flowers. Gus brought some flowers today. Wait a minute, Gus. What do flowers have to do with messing up? How do you mess up around flowers? Do you smell them strangely? What? You always mess up around flowers. Well, how do you do that? I don't understand. How do you... Oh, Gus, did you just eat a flower? Gus, spit it out. There, thank you. Gus, what? You always do that around flowers? What, you just can't help yourself? Oh, I see. You mess up because when you're around flowers, you try to eat them. Oh, that's not good. Boys and girls, you don't want to eat flowers. They can make you really sick. Gus, don't eat the flowers, okay? All right, don't eat the flowers. All right, good. Now, wait. Don't do it, Gus. Don't do it. Wait, maybe boys and girls, we can help him. If you see Gus trying to get near the flowers, will you let me know? Will you shout, Pastor Dave, really loud? All right, Gus, we'll help you out. Okay, so if you see him getting close, you just shout, Pastor Dave, he's trying to eat the flower. Gus, did you eat another flower? Oh, that's why you guys were shouting. I'm sorry. All right, Gus, spit it out. Thank you. All right, well, we still have a couple flowers left. Remember, if you see him getting close, you've got to yell, Pastor Dave, nice and loud. Okay, can you do that for me? Well, you're yelling now. What happened? Oh, I see what happened. Gus, did you try to eat another flower? Spit it out. All right. Well, at least we have one flower left. I'm going to keep it over here so Gus doesn't... What's that? He was trying to get him again? Are you sure? Did you absolutely see him trying to get... What? He got another one! Gus, spit it out! Oh no! Gus, you ate all the flowers! Do you feel bad? Yeah, did he kind of mess up with those flowers? He sure did. Well, here's the thing, Gus. Gus, it's okay. Because even when we mess up, do you know that there is someone who's always with us? Someone who always loves us? Someone who forgives us even when we make big mess ups? Gus, do you know who that is? That's right, it's God. Our Heavenly Father God is always with us. He always loves us, and He forgives us even when we mess up. In fact, He loves us so much that He sent His Son Jesus to die for us on the cross. And when Jesus died on the cross, He washed away our sins, our mistakes, all our mess ups, because God loves us that much. In fact, because Jesus died on the cross, we don't have to feel bad about our mess ups. Instead, we feel excited to be followers of Jesus, because Jesus takes our mess ups and does something amazing. He gives us new life. What? You want to try something? Something about new life? All right, what are you going to do? You're going to breathe on that? All right. Boys and girls, I have no idea what he's doing. All right, Gus is going to breathe on these flowers. And whoa, look at that. We have brand new flowers. Gus, how did you do that? You're amazing. All right, well, remember, as amazing as Gus thinks he is, we have a God who is even more amazing, a God who loves us and sent His Son Jesus to die for us. Even when we mess up, He's with us, He loves us, and He forgives us. All right, we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
All right, thank you so much to Gus the dog for his help with that. All right, we are today, finally into the New Testament. We've been doing this series called Hope Lives, and we've been mostly in the Old Testament. And today we are making it into the book of John, and we're going to be in John chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. At dawn, he appeared again in the temple courts, where all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now what do you say?" They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left, with the woman still standing there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No one, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. "Go now and leave your life of sin." This is the word of the Lord. Today, we are, as I said, finishing up our message series called Hope Lives. And if you've been with us or you've come on and off, we've been in this for the last 7 weeks, and we've been looking at different biblical stories of hope, and how even in very difficult situations, followers of God found hope, and how we can learn from them and have hope today. But today, as we introduce our topic, I have a question. And this question is especially for all the guys out there. So men, pay close attention. But ladies, you can probably relate, perhaps on the other side of this question. So fellas, here's my question, all right? Men, have you ever asked a woman who was pregnant when she was going to be expecting and then found out she wasn't? Mm-hmm. I can see from the painful looks, I am not the only one. Good. And some of the ladies, you've been on the receiving end of this question, perhaps. Hopefully you were pregnant at the time. All right. Now, here's the thing, guys. Most of us, we just make this mistake one time in our entire lives. Some of us, though, we're truly special. We say it more than once. But after you ask a question like that and you realize your enormous mistake and probably were punched in the stomach, what did you want to do? You want to run away, pretend you were insane, join the witness protection program? Well, if you've ever asked a question like that, if you've ever said something or done something, and after you were saying it or right after you did it, you almost pause and you reflect to yourself and you think, what was I even thinking? Well, I want to let you know, today's message, it's for you. Today, we are concluding our series, as you can see on the screen, with the topic, how to find hope when you mess up. Now, I'm not going to ask you to share all your mess ups, but have you ever said or done something that you immediately regret? Have you ever made a mistake that made your life pretty messy? Or maybe you've messed up in such a way that even years later, you're still paying the price for it. Or maybe even today, you are in the middle of a huge mess that you've created, a mistake that you've made that you're embarrassed about or even ashamed of. Well, in our Bible reading today that we just heard, we find a woman who has made a mistake and is in a huge mess. Now, if you go to that chapter, John 8, in your Bible, you're going to notice something a little different. A lot of times it's in italics. Sometimes there's even a little side note, there's an asterisk. And the reason for that is because some of the earliest manuscripts of the Bible, the very earliest copies of the book of John, actually, not just the Bible in whole, but this letter by John, they don't have this section in them. They don't have John 8, 1 through 11 in them. Some later manuscripts show it after John 7, verse 36, some after John chapter 21, or even some put this very same story into the book of Luke. This section was indeed not in the earliest copies of John. It actually doesn't appear in the book of John until about the 12th century, which is a considerable amount of time. But many historians believe it is a credible account and probably was later added from people who did witness it and told others about it. It was very possible that this story about this woman caught in adultery circulated in the early church by those very eyewitnesses who were there. I personally think it's a story we can't just dismiss, and it does seem to be very much in line with Jesus's teachings and his life. So with historical citations aside, what is happening in this section from John 8? Well, it starts with Jesus at the temple courts in Jerusalem. All right, now he's been there for a few days to celebrate a Jewish festival because here's the thing, and this is one of the things, if you're not for sure that you want to be a follower of Jesus, if you think, you know, Christians kind of seem boring, I want to let you know something. Jesus, throughout the Bible, throughout his life recorded in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, he enjoyed a good party. He, in fact, enjoyed a good party so much that one time when a party was suffering, he revived it by turning water into wine. So if you think Christians are boring, just understand that we have a Savior who enjoyed a good party and wasn't afraid to have fun with people. So anyway, Jesus is at the temple courts, and a large crowd of people were around him. And why were they around him? Because, friends, everywhere Jesus was, people wanted to see him and hear him. They wanted to experience Jesus. Even the people who didn't like him couldn't help but be near him. So Jesus is there, and he's teaching the people when he's interrupted. Now, the teachers of the law and the Pharisees come storming into the crowd of people around Jesus. And the teachers and Pharisees, when they come in, are actually smirking, which is probably one of their favorite things to do around Jesus. And the reason for their smirks is they have with them a woman. And this woman is probably just barely clothed. She might even be very exposed at that moment, perhaps just throwing a robe on her. Her head is hung low, and she has that powerful combination of shame and fear. She can't even make eye contact with Jesus. She doesn't want to make eye contact with anyone. And why is it that this woman is so ashamed? Why is it that she's so scared and hanging her head so low? Well, the Pharisees explain with their giant self-righteous smirks, "We've just caught this woman in the act of adultery." You know, in today's world, catching someone in the act of adultery would be a very shameful thing to be caught in. It would be devastating, wouldn't it? Not just for the person, but to everyone involved. But in ancient times, especially in Judaism, this was a very serious offense. You perhaps saw in our Bible reading today when the Pharisees mention, according to Old Testament law from Moses himself, this woman should be killed. More specifically, she should be stoned, killed by throwing rocks at her. This law is precisely why the Pharisees have brought this woman to Jesus. They don't care about what this woman has done. If they cared, don't you think they would have brought someone else with this woman? They would have brought the man, right? You can't commit adultery on your own. You need two. And if they were truly going by Old Testament law, like they are saying they are, then the man would be guilty as well. And it is very possible that the man who was involved with this woman was part of this whole scheme. No, what the Pharisees really care about, and the reason they are smirking and grinning like self-righteous clowns, is they have brought this woman in her shame to try and trap Jesus. They have been trying to find ways to get Jesus in trouble, to have him arrested, and ultimately to have him killed. They think with this woman, they have the perfect trap. If Jesus says she should be let go, then he's breaking the Old Testament law and not obeying what Moses commanded. If Jesus says she should be killed, then his reputation for compassion and forgiveness would have been greatly questioned by the people who followed him. You can almost hear the Pharisees and the teachers of the law just cackling to themselves on how clever they are with all of this. But what about this woman? This woman is being paraded out in front of everyone. And I'm sure there are many people in that crowd around Jesus that knew who she was. She's being paraded about in her shame as an object of ridicule and sin. And she doesn't deny what she has done. She can't. They caught her in the act. But it's not just her reputation that is suffering. The Pharisees want to know if they should kill her. This is a woman without much hope. You know, in ancient times, women had almost zero rights. But an adulteress like this woman had even less than zero rights. She was seen as filth, as garbage, as worthless. But Jesus, in our story, does something strange. He does something that changes this woman's destiny and brings a powerful hope. First, he bends down and starts drawing in the dirt. Have you ever wondered, if you've read this before, or maybe as you read it, what does he draw? We don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us. Maybe he just doodles a picture. Maybe it was one of those, like, you know, 3D cubes that I always would draw during math class. Or maybe he just writes WWJD. Or maybe he even just draws an arrow pointing to the smuggest Pharisee, and he just writes, "I'm with stupid." But no matter what, the Pharisees keep questioning him as he draws on what to do. And so Jesus stands up and he speaks. And he says, "Let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." When he says this, the Pharisees go silent. Their smirks are gone. Their mouths are now wide open. Because Jesus is showing an understanding of Moses' law that the Pharisees couldn't have foreseen. For according to the Old Testament laws found in the book of Deuteronomy, you were only allowed to execute someone for committing a particular sin if you were innocent of that sin. This wasn't just Jesus asking the Pharisees, "Are you sinless in all that you do?" because none of them were. He was asking them, "Are you sinless in all matters of adultery as well. Are you completely innocent of the very crime that you are accusing this woman of? Not just the act of adultery, but having adulterous thoughts. Jesus was asking them in that moment, are you innocent of this? Are you sinless in this? And then he goes back to drawing on the ground. You know, some biblical scholars think perhaps as he begins drawing again, he starts writing down some of the sins that these Pharisees have committed. Perhaps even sins of adultery. Some think perhaps he starts spelling out what adultery really means to God. But based on what he says and what he writes in the dirt, something phenomenal happens. All these self-righteous teachers of the law, all these Pharisees, they stop smirking, they hang their heads, and what do? They walk away. Why? Why do they walk away? Well, that's our first point today on how to find hope when you mess up. They walk away because only one is perfect. There is hope for the woman, not because no one is perfect, as we like to say, but there is hope because only one is perfect. These teachers of the law, these experts on the rules, they're not without sin, and they know it. We live in a fallen world, and sin is everywhere. We all make mistakes. We all have failed. We all fall short. Some of us might be better at hiding it than others. But we don't find our hope in the failures of others. We find our hope knowing there is one who did not fail. There is one who could keep all of Moses' laws perfectly. And the woman finds hope in this one person, this man known as Jesus. Jesus did what no human could do. He lived a perfect life free from sin, free from mistakes and failures. He said he didn't come to destroy the law. He came to fulfill it, and he did. This perfect man is the only one left standing before the woman. He has dismissed the others, and he is her hope. He stands before her not with a look of condemnation. He stands before her with a look of love and compassion. So how about you? How about you and me? With our messes, do you ever feel like a failure? Take a look around. You are surrounded by billions of people who have messed up too. It's called being a human. But don't take this wrong. This isn't about comparing ourselves to others, because we can always find someone who's messed up more or less than us in a particular instance. But we find our hope by following the one who is perfect. We find our hope by understanding there is one without sin. His name is Jesus, and he stands before you, not looking to rub your nose in your mess, looking to cast the first stone and strike you down. He stands before you with love and compassion. Then in the story, Jesus asks the woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? And she responds, probably with a very meek and shocked voice, no one, sir. And Jesus answers, then neither do I condemn you. This short discussion is so powerful because this is what following Jesus is all about. Jesus did not come into this world to condemn it. He came to save it. He did not come into this world to point out our mistakes. The law does that very well, thank you very much. He came into this world to take our messes on himself and forgive us. But Jesus understands something in this conversation that this woman probably doesn't. He understands that for this guilty, shameful woman to be forgiven, there is a cost. As lopsided and pathetic as this whole scenario with the Pharisees was, this woman did violate the law and commit adultery. She sinned. God loves us, but God cannot tolerate sin. He can't because he is holy and he is perfect. And Jesus knows that a price must be paid for this woman's sin and for all of our sins. This price is what I call fearless forgiveness. And this, my friends, is the good news of Jesus. He gives his life as a sacrifice for our sins. He pays the price for us. He says there is a consequence for your sins, but I will take the consequence so you can be closer to my Father, so you can be forgiven and your sins washed away. He pays the price. I've heard it said that forgiveness is free, but it isn't cheap. Jesus paid dearly with his life and his blood for you. He paid for you because you were that valuable to him and to God. You were worth the price. Turn to the person next to you, if you have someone sitting next to you, and look at them right in the eye and say, you were worth the price. And if you're by yourself, say it to yourself, I am worth the price. I want you to pause here and think about what you just said. I am worth the price. You are worth the price. Jesus is willing to die for the sins of this rejected woman. He's willing to die for the sins of you and of me. But do you really believe it? Do you really believe that through Jesus Christ, you are forgiven? Do you really believe it's true? And my question, if you say yes, is then why do you and so many other people who claim to be followers of Christ, why do we struggle so much to believe this? Why is it so hard for us to believe that we are forgiven? And as you think about that, that's our discussion question for today. Do you really believe you're forgiven? And why can this be so hard to believe? So we're just going to pause for a moment. You can reflect on it. You can discuss it. And then we'll meet right back. All right, I hope you had a chance to ponder on that, to think about that. In my experience, a lot of people who are both Christian and non-Christian, struggle with this. Why? Because as humans, we feel guilty. Some of us might claim that we don't need to be forgiven, but if you really press into people, you'll find the majority of people have guilt. The majority of people know that they've messed up. But we have a tendency as humans to fight against forgiveness. We have a tendency to want to hold on to our messes and our mistakes as proof that we aren't very good people sometimes. We like to look at our messes and say, see, I'm not anything special. I'm not anything worthy. We also feel like we should have to do more to be forgiven, that we should have to earn our forgiveness somehow. Maybe we think we need to do a whole bunch of stuff, a whole bunch of good deeds. We need to live better, and then we can be forgiven. Well, friends, the truth is that through Jesus, you are forgiven, period. He died on a cross for you because you are worth it. You are valuable You are loved. That woman in our Bible reading found hope in fearless forgiveness, the fearless forgiveness of Jesus. I hope that you find that same hope and that same fearless forgiveness as well. As I think about that fearless forgiveness of Jesus, I'm reminded of a story about a young lady who had immigrated to the United States from Cuba. And being a very strong Catholic follower, she wanted to attend confession. Perhaps you've heard of that, where you go in privately into a booth with a priest and you confess your sins. And she wanted to confess her sins in English to the priest. So she had her friend translate her list of sins into English, which that better be a really good friend if you're having them translate your sins. But she had her friend write out all these English words kind of phonetically so she could pronounce them. So she could use her very limited knowledge of English but still confess her sins. So she went into the confession booth, which is separated by a thin wall between you and the priest with a little divider that they can open and close. And she said the first phrase she had memorized in English. And with a very thick Spanish accent, she said, "Father, forgive me, for I have sinned." Then she looked down at her list, but the problem was it was very dark in the confessional booth. She couldn't read it. So she said again, hoping her eyes would adjust to the dark light around her, "Father, forgive me, for I have sinned." Then in obvious frustration, she said in Spanish, "I can't see my sins." To which the priest responded in perfect Spanish, "You are forgiven. Go and sin no more." I love that little story because that's us. Sometimes we can't even see the sins. We have so much on us. There's so many hurts and wounds that we can't even list them out. And yet God says, "You are forgiven. You are forgiven through my son." Now, our story with this woman and Jesus is almost done. But Jesus has one more thing to tell this woman. One last word of advice. And it's right at the very end of verse 11. He says, "Go now and leave your life of sin." Or as some translations put it, "Go and sin no more." You know, this seems like a really odd thing to say. After all, how can this woman stop sinning? She's human, and as humans, we're sinners. But Jesus isn't asking her to go out and be perfect. He knows she can't do that. He is telling her, don't go back to doing what you were doing. Don't go back to adultery. Don't go back to the life you were leading just a few moments ago. Instead, live this life for me. Live this life as one who has experienced Jesus and has been forgiven. Jesus isn't telling this woman, "Hey, adultery is no big deal. Go out and enjoy life." He is telling her, "You've been forgiven, but it's time to live differently." Jesus forgives sin, but he never promotes the sin. Jesus is 100% grace, friends, but he's also 100% truth. He loves you, he forgives you, but he wants you to live differently. He wants you to live differently because you are forgiven by him. He doesn't want you to live differently because you are scared of punishment. He wants you to live differently because you are in awe of his love and forgiveness. Now, let me shift the gears just for a second. You know, as a kid, I'll be honest, I never really liked summer vacation. You see, I grew up on a farm, and summer vacation on the farm meant I had to do a lot more work, especially out in the fields with our strawberries and taking care of our cows. And I had learned at a young age, school was a lot easier than that hard work. But another reason I didn't enjoy summer vacation, and maybe some of you can relate to this when you think about your own childhood, one of the reasons I didn't like summer vacation was the TV shows. You see, back in the prehistoric days, before Dish Network, Netflix, Disney Plus, and all the streaming channels, we only had a small number of broadcast channels. If you have no idea what I'm talking about, you're probably younger than 25 years old. But during this summertime, during what we would call the primetime hours of TV, would any of these channels, if you remember, would they run new episodes of your favorite shows, yes or no, during the summer? No. What would they have during the summer? Reruns. They would show reruns. Now, if you don't know what a rerun is, it's basically showing the same show that you showed earlier again. In fact, in the summer, you could pretty much rewatch the entire season of your favorite show again. It's kind of like binge watching on Netflix, except you had to wait a week in between. I never really liked reruns because I'd already seen them. I wanted something new, something different. Well, I share this with you because the same is true for our faith. And this is the last point on how to find hope when you mess up. Don't live for reruns. And you'll notice, if you don't know who those two people are, we've got Gilligan and the Skipper from the show Gilligan's Island. Because when I think of reruns, that was like the king of summer reruns right there. I think they made like 6 episodes and then showed it about 6 billion times. But here's the thing. Jesus wants us to live differently. He wants us to be just like the woman from our story, to experience his fearless forgiveness, his love, but then he wants us to go out and live for him. He doesn't want us to just go back to living in the mess again. You want to find hope when you mess up? Don't live for reruns. Don't keep going back to your mess and doing it again and again. For some of you, this is going to be hard. I know it. It might mean that you're going to have to block some sites on your internet. It might mean you're not going to hang out with some of the people who are living in that mess still. It might mean you're not going to go back to vices and temptations that you know are only going to increase the mess. Again, we don't live for reruns. Not because we are in fear of losing our forgiveness. We don't live for reruns because we've experienced Jesus and we want to live for him. You know, there's a story of an old farmer who had a long-standing feud with a man who used to be his best friend. The story goes like this. Old Frank was dying. For years, he had been at odds with Bill, his former best friend. Wanting to straighten things out, he sent word for Bill to come and see him. When Bill arrived, Frank told him that he was afraid to go into eternity with such bad feelings between them. Then very reluctantly and with great effort, Frank apologized for things he had said and done to Bill. He also assured Bill that he forgave him for his offenses against him. Everything seemed fine until Bill turned to go. And as Bill walked out of the room, Frank called out after him, "But remember, if I get better, this doesn't count." Friends, that's not how it works. You don't go back to your mess if you start feeling better. You don't go back to your mess if you feel more optimistic. You don't go back to your mess again. Instead, you find your hope in Jesus. Well, as we close out this final message in our Hope Lives series, next week we'll be starting a new series together. I want you to know that hope does live. No matter how bad things can get, no matter how big our messes are, Jesus is with us. He loves us, he forgives us, and he wants us to follow him. And so we're going to end this message with a short video, a video on perhaps what this woman from our story might have experienced after meeting Jesus, and maybe even later after Jesus dies on the cross. So let's take a look.
I've been caught outright and dragged straight into open daylight. Bystanders gawking, the village women absorbing every morsel of gossip. Common decency dictated that the shame of the moment was enough. But the law called for something greater. My life. Of course, a long audience followed behind. Don't think I didn't recognize a couple of them. Their words condemned me, but they didn't dare look me in the eye. I did everything to try to cover my shame, but I couldn't hide from the onlookers or this holy man whose feet they threw me to. I was finished. I stared at the ground when he said that whoever was sinless, they should go first. They should throw the first stone. I squeezed my eyes shut, grasping at the gravel, waiting for the end of my life to unfold. Nothing, though. Then footsteps. Except they were walking away. I looked up. Is there no one left to accuse you? He asked me. No. I don't either. He said, go and sin no more. How he ended up on the cross. And as he hung there dying, he didn't say, I am finished. He said, it is finished. That's something different. That's a different thing. It means that something is accomplished, restored. He restored my hope. My self-respect and my dignity. I didn't even know I had any left. On a day when I thought that my life was finished, the only man there holy enough to demand justice handed me mercy.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Take me as you find me, and all my sins fail yours. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Oh, I surrender. salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. And Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
Thank you, Caleb and Sadra. Friends, I don't know what mess ups you've had in your life. I don't know what failures and mistakes that you have. You might be carrying a lot on you right now. And I want you to know that if you don't remember anything else today, know that you have hope, that you have hope in Jesus, not because of what you do or what you are going to do, but what he has done for you. Now we move into our time of Holy Communion together. I'm going to give you a moment if you want to get your beverage. And I know some of you have been using some creative things for your beverages. We're not here to judge. Just go ahead and grab whatever you have. Grab whatever beverage you have and grab your cracker or your bread. And we will move into our Holy Communion time. We begin with what's called the words of institution, the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples during what we call the Last Supper. And these are right out of Scripture. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen. At this time, please distribute your communion, the body of Christ shed for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Once you're done, go ahead and take a few moments to pray together. All right. I hope you had a chance to pray, and thank you. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for sharing together as we're united together in Holy Communion throughout with all our Christian brothers and sisters throughout the world. At this time, I'm going to invite you to unmute your microphones if you'd like, and we're going to speak what we call the benediction, the blessing. All right. This always gets a little rowdy. But put your hands up if you want. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, friends. Let's go out serving God and creating community through
love, service, and laughter.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. Remember, every Sunday, we'll still do with us until you hear otherwise. But remember, most importantly, you are loved. You are important. You have hope. Amen. Now, all right. Have a great rest of your day.
Come over to the church room.
Thank you, Pastor Dave.